Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Puberty Blues, written by Kathy Lette and Gabrielle Carey, and read by Rebecca Macauley. The dedication reads, to Virginia Ferguson, our literary godmother. Foreword by Kylie Minogue. I don't recall reading Puberty Blues so much as devouring it. I was about 13, alone in my bedroom with the door firmly shut. I'd shimmied my way waist high under the bed with my bare feet over the heating duct. Perfect. I was whisked into a world of boys, the beach and best friends, of pimples, periods and panel vans. Such things were important to know and I was fascinated. The honesty of the story made it hysterical and terrifying at the same time. The language was identifiable and spoke volumes through its simplicity. Needless to say, I was straight on the phone for a ridiculous length of time to my bestie as soon as I'd finished. A uniquely Australian experience and a fond memory of my early teenage years. 2002. Foreword by Jermaine Greer. Puberty Blues is not only a period piece, nor is its colour merely local. The tribal society into which Debbie and Sue are so painfully and destructively inducted still rules in the dead reaches of suburbia, wherever it may be found, in Johannesburg, Los Angeles, Miami, Baltimore, Perth, wherever. Even in sleepy English country towns, you can see schoolgirls posing round the bus stop, waiting for hours for the gangs of boys to take notice of them and to include them, always on the boys' terms, in whatever activity is going forward. If there is no beach, there will be something else. Road racing in their own or stolen cars on the nearest straight stretch of tarmac, for instance. With luck, the girls won't get caught up in joyriding or ram raiding or tormenting and terrorising vulnerable people. Hanging out is more likely to involve alcohol, ecstasy, smoking and casual sex in the 21st century than it was in the 1970s. The only lifestyle that is worth living is hedonistic, and the only pleasurable exploits open to young teenagers involve breaking the law, one way or another. Everything in the commercial culture to which our children are exposed says to them, whatever you fancy, get it and get it now. Waiting, as the law and parents demand, is for mugs and cowards. The cool kids are the ones who have it all. TV soap opera has sold the seaside suburbs of Sydney to the British public as a kind of working-class paradise, where boys are emotionally responsible and girls are relatively independent, where everybody is honest about their feelings, informed about drugs, venereal disease and contraception, where peer group pressure is exerted in the service of the common good, where neighbours are there for one another, and kids can get away with very little. The truth is very different. The boredom that so terrorised Debbie and Sue has deepened into total inertia and deep silence. In most of the endless streets of Australian suburbian, absolutely nothing is happening, except behind the closed doors of teenagers' bedrooms, on the net and on the phone. Nowadays, the location for the weekend's rave is published on the net at the last minute. The venue is usually Crown Land, so that no one can be busted for allowing drugs to be sold on the premises, and the dealers are there in droves. Be there or be square. There always were kids who opted to be square, the others who yearn for adventure and find none that is not self-destructive and or criminal are probably the majority. Puberty Blues is a profoundly moral story, which should chill the marrow of parents of today's 13-year-olds. Debbie and Sue are the only ones among their peers to reject their slavish dependence on the boys and motivate themselves to accomplish something before their options are inexorably cancelled one by one. Gabrielle Carey and Kathy Lette don't tell us how they did it. If we want to motivate our children to follow their example, we cannot leave it to dumb luck. 2002. Chapter 1. Down the beach. When we were 13, the coolest things to do were the things your parents wouldn't let you do. Things like have sex, smoke cigarettes, nick off from school, go to the drive-in, take drugs, and go to the beach. The beach was the centre of our world. Rain, snow, hail, a two-hour wait at the bus stop, all being grounded, nothing could keep us from the surf. Us little surfy chicks, chirping our way down on the train. Hundreds of us in little white shirts, short-sleeve jumpers, thongs and straight-leg Levi's covering little black bikinis. We flocked to the beach. Cheap, cheap. There were three main sections of Cronulla Beach: South Cronulla, North Cronulla and Green Hills. Everyone was trying to make it to Green Hills. That's where the top surfy gang hung out. The prettiest girls from school and the best surfies on the beach. The bad surfboard riders on their L plates, the Italian family groups and the uncool kids from Bankstown, Bankies, swarmed to South Cronulla, dickhead land. That's where it all began. We were dickheads. If you were lucky, your boyfriend would meet you at the station, but usually it was a half-day search through blonde-headed, denim-legged, cigarette-smoking surfboard riders, searching for your Greg, your Wayne, your Bruce, whoever you happened to be going around with at the time. I was going around with Greg. I'd met him at South Cronulla. He was my first ever surfy boyfriend. He couldn't surf, but he was better than a banky. He may have had a red cool light, but he'd stuck a fin in it. Sue had her eye on Daryl. He was Greg's best friend. Sue was mine. Off went the boys into the big blue sea. Sue and I sat there on the sand. 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, warming up the towel, folding his clothes into neat little piles, fetching the banana fritters and chocolate thick shakes, and watching him chuck endless re-entries.
Did you see me, Neil?
Yeah, it was great.
I got this really good one, and I looked up and you weren't looking.
I was. I saw you. I did.
Where's the fritters?
Here. By this time, Sue and I were starving too, but we couldn't eat anything. Skinniness was inniness. Girls never ate in front of their boyfriends. It was unladylike to open your mouth and shove something in it. We were also busting to go to the dunny, but that was too rude for girls. Our stomachs rumbled and our bladders burst. It was a great day at the beach. Then off they went again, into the big blue sea. And there we sat. 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, checking out the guys, sneaking a red ice block and flirting when I thought Greg wasn't looking. To pass the time, we kept an eyeball peeled for our dreaded enemies, the bankies from the greasy western suburbs. They were easy to spot with their yellow T-shirts, Amco jeans, terry toweling hats, one-piece swimming costumes, worn-out cool light surfboards and white zinc plastered from ear to ear.
Oh, I'd wear Amcos for sure.
Spot on. Like your cool light. Bankstowner. Pew. We gave them heaps. Finally, the sun went down and out came a little blonde, bedraggled, dripping, drowned rat. My boyfriend. While Greg and Daryl got changed, they sent us off to get their munchies. The art of changing in and out of board shorts at the beach was always done behind a towel or when your girlfriend was at the shop. The ultimate disgrace for a surfie was being seen in his scungies. They were too much like underpants. The boys didn't want us checking out the size of their dicks. Greg gorged the meat pie I bought him as we walked up to the station.
Where's my towel?
He asked halfway there. I haven't got it.
Well, I haven't got it. Wait here. Mind this.
He handed me a half a sloppy tomato sauce sodden meat pie.
And don't eat it.
Okay. Off he ran, thongs flapping, blonde hair flowing. Then it was a half hour wait. I was starving. The meat pie was getting cold. There it was in my hot little hand.
Where's my pie?
I looked at him blankly.
Where's my pie?
Sue and I stood speechless.
You ate it!
He threw his towel at me.
You're dropped.
Not to worry. He was to drop me 94 more times in our relationship. But in the end, I dropped Greg. He was a rotten surfer. He could only kneel. I decided he was a bit of a banky. You didn't have to come from Bankstown to be a banky. It just meant anyone who was uncool. Sue dropped Daryl too. We didn't tell them. We just started hanging at North Cronulla. North Cronulla was north of South Cronulla, and exactly the same, really. Except the waves were bigger. The boys were older. The shop was closer. The hair was longer, and the rank was higher. We checked out a group of guys sitting on the hill. The Hill Gang. Sue and I walked past a few times and then sat on the rocks nearby. Giggling, we glanced in their direction. I widened my eyes and pouted, trying to look cute. Finally, they came over and asked for the time. Soon I was going round with Mark. He was cooler than the South Cronullaites. He had a real Jackson surfboard with two fins on it, a twin fin. Sue had her eye on Warwick. He was Mark's best friend. Off he went into the deep blue sea, and there I sat on the hill, warming up the towel, folding his clothes into neat little piles, fetching the Chico rolls, and watching him chuck endless cutbacks. When he was a long way out, Sue and I checked out the guys. They were spunkier at North Cronulla. The spunk was thicker and the bankies fewer. There he is! It was Darren Peters, the top surfing spunk of the sixth form. Where?
There! Over there on the wall.
Oh, God. What a doll.
Oh, what do we do? Follow him? Nah, just sit here. Oh, no, he's looking.
Don't look.
Smile. No. I think I'm trying to crack onto him. Oh, there he goes. Oh.
Oh, he's with that mole. Lucky bitch. She was a mole because she walked everywhere in a bikini. That meant she was showing off her body and was an easy route. You could sit in your bikini, but never walk. Spring, summer, autumn, winter, we walked along the beach in Levi's, white shirts and thongs. But then there were the banky bikini wearers. One day as we sat there on the hill in the blazing hot sun in full dress uniform, a few of our North Cronulla gang started to chuckle. We looked up. There, walking along the beachfront, was a tall, skinny, pretzel-looking albino beanpole in a terry toweling bikini.
Check out the mohair stockings!
I'd walk along the beach with a figure like that for sure. She walked along the sand oblivious, leaving a blazing trail of sniggering brown surfies. Her white, hairy body glowed as she loped up the beach.
Flatsy, flatsy, you're flat and that's that,
we chorused mockingly. Untold zits.
Hey, ghost features.
She turned around. I nudged Sue in horror. It was Judy, Sue's next door neighbour. We ducked, suddenly fascinated by my right thong. If she saw us, we were goners. She'd rush over and say hello. It wasn't cool to know a banky chick. We'd be expelled by the Hill Gang and sent back to South Cronulla in disgrace with our towels between our legs. Back to dickhead land, where there were millions of Judies with flat chests, hairy legs and coolites. Mark saved the day.
Where's me Chico roll?
He said, dripping all over us. We ran all too enthusiastically up the beach in the opposite direction. Sue and I were trying to make it into the ultimate surfy gang at Greenhills. It was special. The prettiest and coolest girls at school and the best surfers on the beach. Brown and blonde, they stood out in the school playground. The girls were skinny, hair-free, carefree and girly. They wore the shortest uniforms, the most mascara and a friendship ring. 99% of their time was spent on the roofs of their houses with a bottle of baby oil. For hours they basked, baked and blistered, trying to get browner than Tracy and Cheryl. Sylvania Heights is full of 19-year-old girls looking like shriveled-up 90-year-olds. The passport into this surfy gang was a brief halter-neck bikini, a pair of straight-legged Levi's, a packet of Marlboro cigarettes, a suntan and, if you really wanted to make it, long, blonde hair. To graduate into the surfy gang, you had to be desired by one of the surfy boys, tell off a teacher, do the Scotch drawback, and know all about sex. You had to be not too fat, but not too skinny. You had to be not too slack, but not too tight. Friendly, but not forward. You had to wear just enough makeup, but never overdo it. You had to be interested in surfing, but not interested enough to surf. The surfy girls had a special walk. It was a slow and casual meander. They slouched their shoulders, sunk into their hips, and thrust their pelvises forward. The surfy boys were brown and broad. The longer and blonder the hair, the better. They never wore full school uniform. Their shirts were always hanging out. If they wore school ties, they hung like limp spaghetti round their necks. They never wore underpants but kept their scungies on at all times, always ready to leap into the surf. The better they surfed, the higher their rank. The passport into a surfy gang for boys was a surfboard, a pair of board shorts, a pair of straight-leg Levi's, packet of Marlboro cigarettes, and long blonde hair. To graduate into the surfy gang, you had to have your name called out at assembly, regular canings, and have broken in a couple of young surfy chicks. The surfy boys had a special walk. They bounded along in their rubber thongs, keeping their torso stiff, sturdy as a lighthouse. Every school in the southern Sydney suburbs had a surfy gang. The in cool heavies. They had all the fun. They sneaked down to the creek to kiss and cuddle at lunchtime. They smoked cigarettes. They put eggshells in Mrs. Yellen's peanut butter sandwich. On sunny days, they truanted and went to the beach. Then there'd be a big hole in the middle of the quadrangle, at lunchtime, where they usually sat. They had their claimed territory that no one else ventured upon, at school, up the back of the bus, and at the beach. They went out together on Friday and Saturday nights. They got drunk. They had boyfriends and girlfriends. They disobeyed their parents. But the surfy gang had a big, more important family of its own. The kids who weren't in on the gang spent Friday and Saturday nights at home. They wore flared Amco jeans. They read books. They went to church fellowship and had never heard of Led Zeppelin. If you weren't a surfy chick, you were a nobody. You were a nerd. You could always tell nerds at school. They wore their uniforms longer than ours, 2 inches over their underpants. They were goody-goodies. They didn't smoke. They never went on detention. Never got their names called out at assembly. They were never in the corridor, never in the headmaster's office, and never up the back of the bus. But most of all, they didn't have boyfriends. If they were going round with anyone, he was bound to have short back and sides, acne, and play handball. We thought they were virgin prudes. Once you made it into the surfy gang, you were a top chick with a spunky boyfriend. Everyone knew who you were, and you knew everyone who mattered. More than anything, Sue and I wanted to be in the Green Hills gang. We went through endless packets of Marlboro, practicing the drawback. We took up our uniforms. We roasted on the roof all day and rubbed cream into each other all night. If you wanted to get into the gang, you had to crawl after and suck up to all the gang girls.
Sure, I can lend you 10 cents. Here you are. Have me lunch. Dead set, I'm not hungry. I just had a curry chop in home science.
Geez, you look pretty on Friday night at the dance, Kim.
Yeah, all the guys were stoked. Should have seen Darren Peters looking at you.
Yeah, reckon. Kerry's a two-faced bitch. I hate her too.
We lent them our bus fares and walked home. We told them how good they looked, offered them cigarettes, agreed with whatever they said, and laughed at all their jokes. But nothing worked. We just couldn't get into the Green Hills gang. At 8 o'clock every morning, there'd be a mad rush for the back of the school bus. Everybody had their appointed seat. Every day, the same seat next to the same person. Sue and I raced up the aisle.
Oh, watch out!
I shrieked, tripping.
I put me bag in the middle of the aisle for sure.
The smoke was already billowing up from the back of the bus. We sat 3 seats from the back.
Give me a cigarette,
moaned Sue.
I'm so nervous. I didn't do any study. I'm packing shit.
It's cool. I hitched up my uniform, revealing a list of the Industrial Revolution's consequences between 1850 and 1919. The tops of my thighs were green and blue, covered with facts and dates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.